just another in the hospital. She, I understand she may have to get out tomorrow, but that's not confirmed yet. So keep her in prayer as well. See, since Ruth is not with us today, so keep her in prayer as well as Matthew and Mike. Keep her in prayer. As you know, Tim Morrison's father passed away this week.
I think they both have COVID, so, you know, if anybody wants to call them, it's a chance you get them the answer. Most of the time they've been sleeping, but I don't advise anybody to go there just because of them both having fevers and everything.
Thank you. Paula, once again, I stand before you here with all of us saying, all of him, all of the sisters, me, Tim, and Bob, and you can hear today, every Father, Lord. I take this opportunity, every Father, every each and every one of you, just every Father, Lord, that if any of us, your glory, he is higher than ever, for him, Father, be forthcoming in their lives, every Father, Lord. Lord, I take this opportunity also, every Father, to thank you, and bless you for still, once each and every day, every Father, Lord. Thank you for the prayers you've asked this past week and the ones we're going to have to hear today, Heavenly Father, Lord. Lord, you can praise and glory, Heavenly Father, Lord, for just lifting us up in our time of need and despair, Heavenly Father, Lord. Always being there for us, Heavenly Father, we can come to get guidance, get wisdom, get healing, get satisfied in our needs, Heavenly Father, Lord. Today we'll be yet for your grace and your glory. Your word, you tell us, Heavenly Father, to bring our word to you. And in these troubled times we're living in, we've got quite a few baggage we're carrying on our shoulders, Heavenly Father, Lord. We ask you at this hour to lighten our load and take the word away from us, Heavenly Father, Lord. Lord, if you bring it to the altar and then leave it at the foot of the cross, your burden will be lightened on your shoulders and the burden will be lifted, Heavenly Father, Lord. I know it's not through your grace and glory. Thank you.
morning.
Amen.
I'm going to stand up and sing this because he's bigger than any problem you're going to face. Let's praise him a little this morning, church, and if that's what you can.
That's all I can make.
giving a letter to the church.
And I would, I can't tell you how many times, but as the Lord is continuing to grow me, I started to realize I had read it all wrong. And when you read it wrong, you come up with erroneous conclusions. And so God will take you, and as the Holy Spirit starts to illuminate the scriptures, suddenly you have those aha moments. Anybody ever have one of them where you're like, oh my goodness.
Oh yeah.
I had to read this thing just so wrong the whole time. We always talk about sin outside the world, but we rarely talk about sin inside the body of Christ in believers. I'm talking about every one of us, okay? Yeah. All sin becomes for the glory of God. And we all, if we're not careful, will develop what I believe he was trying to communicate here, a fault line in our life. For most of you, I'm not talking about fault as in what you're going to think. I'm referring to it in regards to an earthquake. To understand a fault line, that's where two things meet. Two pieces of land are being pressed together, and that pressure builds and builds over time, and eventually it moves and it creates a great disturbance around it. In our spiritual lives, I told you before, we feel like when we got two squirrels chasing each other up a tree, my brain sometimes. Those two tectonic plates of the Holy Spirit versus the devil on my ear trying to tell me, there is great pressure inside of our minds and our hearts. There's a fault line, and at some point, if it is not dealt with before God, there's going to be a great shaking. Now, a smaller quake will rattle your nerves. If anybody's ever been in one, how do you remember a few years back when they had one up near D.C.? I happened to be up in Goldsboro that day, and we actually felt the ground shake. It was the weirdest thing you've ever experienced. But there are those hidden fault lines. In December 2004, these two plates under the Indian Ocean had built up for years and will release one of the most powerful earthquakes in history. And subsequently, that hidden fault line that was not visible to the human eye erupted and sent, it sent a wall of water around many places of the globe. It affected things literally thousands of miles away. Total destruction because of the ensuing tsunami. Most of you remember the Thailand tsunami. It didn't just hit Thailand. If you look, it went all the way to Africa, which was not next door, by the way. That's a pretty good way to cross the Indian Ocean then. If we do not deal with these fault lines in our life, John, here he is trying to tell us, the Apostle John, they're going to cause a moral earthquake in your life if you do not deal with these seismic fault lines in your life. We've had many discussions about this very issue, especially on Wednesday nights. By the way, this is a two-part message. If it didn't, y'all would be like, that's the most long-winded man I have ever heard in my life. I'm going to make it one point out of three. This is deep, but this is vital. It will change, A, the way you understand what he's saying here, who he's speaking to, but it's going to change your life. Because the truth is, these fault lines exist, or have the potential to exist in every believer. Just because we're saved from sin doesn't mean we no longer sin. However, we should be ready, and this is what we have discussed. Well, do we confess our sins, or, you know, if you're saved and they're covered, you know, what's the point? I'm going to tell you what the point is. When you get a grain or a speck in your eye, you sit there and wait. Now, you immediately try to get that out of there. It's an irritant. when sin comes into the believer's life, we need to get it out.
Yeah.
It is an irritance. It means we confess to God. And I'm going to lay that out here for you in a very full way. One of the greatest fault lines, we're talking about Paul, says the San Andreas fault. We've all heard of that. Twice in the last century, two major eruptions that really decimated San Francisco. And I was alive, most of us were alive in the last one. Remember in 1989? Pictures of the freeway that had collapsed on people. Then you go back to 1906 and that whole city burned down. These fault lines must be dealt with. Just because they're out of sight don't mean they're out of mind. And it depends on the location and the intensity as to whether or not it's going to produce just a little shake or a tidal wave. And when you start talking about the church, you're talking about casualties along the way. So we have to look at these fault lines and look at them through a biblical perspective, because our whole Christian experience is based on relationships. First with God, and then one with another. But anyway, preach you that. Those are the two things, love God and love each other.
Amen.
That is all about the fundamentals of relationships. But sin will sneak in the gap sometimes and will try and shake the boat. He will create fault lines. And we've got to be on guard for these fault lines or we can see great damage. The longer it's hidden, the greater the pressure, the bigger the fault line. Primarily, this section of scripture deals with, get this, a believer's, now you like this, but I'm going to teach it to you anyway, secret faults and hidden sins. Anybody who thinks just because you're saved,
yeah, I get typical of those people, they just bounce around. And I told you, my mother had somebody come to her church one time and say, I haven't sinned in 10 years. Sit right on the pulpit. I'm sitting there looking like the earth a few minutes ago. Really, that's interesting because that don't match up with the Bible. Should I go sit in the conference and go to see if he's got breath? If that one got my attention, I did not sleep. I'll say that much. He had my attention.
But what we have here is sin, and the Bible is the only book on planet Earth that tells us how to deal with sin specifically and to recognize sin for what it is. We are in a generation, this day and time, folks, and you know this, you've seen it over and over, and if you watch any amount of news, they don't even like to call things sin anymore. You know, somebody just made a bad decision, a bad judgment, or a bad choice, or they're the victim of one thing or another. It's never the person's fault. Like I said, we've all sinned. We need to quit playing the role of victim, because the victim will allow you to stay in the position that you're in. And God doesn't want you to stay in the position you're in. He is trying to move you to the position where He's in, which is a holy and acceptable life. But you can't do that until you start to acknowledge these fault lines in your life. Realize they exist. Many people believe that the word sin itself is even out of date. Today, sin is called a mistake or misjudgment. The phrase Jesus did not go to Calvary and die for a mistake or for somebody's misjudgment. He went to the cross for yours and my sin.
Amen.
Don't you make that error in your thinking. We live in an age of behavioristic psychology. You notice that? Everybody's trying. but I don't care. I'm just going to be plain with you. I pray for somebody's soul. I don't care what they've done as far as their soul goes. I don't care why Jeffrey Dahmer wanted to kill people and eat them. It doesn't matter to me. The dude was demonic. Same thing for any of these people that go out and are just serial murderers. I don't care how their mind thinks. I think what was motivating them, and it wasn't the Holy Spirit of God. But today, all these distinguished people with their bow tongues want to hear the silver lesson. See if I can get in their mind and understand. And their mind is messed up, it's the heart. When we start getting to the heart of the matter, we'll start to understand where our problems lie. Because guess what? Out of our hearts can come the same junk we've left unchecked without the Holy Spirit. You can think real highly of yourself. And we're nice and smiling and pretty right now because we're in a very comfortable place. We have food in our belly and shoes on our feet. We've got this nice facilities to be in. But what would happen if we're like the saints, if someone like Iraq, Iran, and China, hidden underground, praying, and listening for noises outside, waiting for people to come in with guns to blow your head off and your children's heads off? Would you still be sitting here so nonchalant? I mean, we got to get this thing straight, and John's really laying it on here. We're going to get to it. Like I said, this is a two-part message because there was an awful lot to get to. Today's psychologist says that we're just the sum total of our genes, our chromosomes, and the environment. So actually, man is not wicked. He's just weak. He's not sinful. He's sick. This is what they're teaching. Man's not really evil. He's just ill. And they are pushing this full throttle on education, starting from the very youngest right on up into the, quote, higher learnings we're going to touch on a little bit. Because of this, many people will never get to the root of the problem in their lives. Like I said, they're too busy blaming everybody else. It's my mom's fault. It's my daddy's fault. It's my grandparents' fault. It's my neighbor's fault. We're all adults in here to grow up. It's time to stand up. It's time to take charge. Quit being the victim and start being the champion that God's called you out of. He's came to set you free of those things. I'm not here to put you down. I'm here to pick you up through God's word and say, you are more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. Look at those things that are hurt you, have put you down. Look at them. Quit running from them. Look them straight in the face. Say, you had your day. It's over. Done. I'm not going to be hurt anymore. I've got a Savior that loved me so much that He died for me. There's nothing that any man, woman, or child can do to you that Christ didn't already repair at Calvary. He's the great fixer up. I will get the scripture in a minute. I told you this was going to take a while. But I'm laying out a very important groundwork, so please stick with it. We're never getting to the root of the problem because of this. We've been taught in the theory of evolution that man was not created, but rather that he evolved from some sort of primordial soup. First we were one cell, and then two cells, and I guess eventually the ankle bone connected to the problem is everything where the soup came from. But the Bible does. It says God in the beginning. God spoke. And if you look at the way they have even seen the universe expanding, they call it the Big Bang. I call it God speaking.
Amen.
It makes a lot more sense to understand that and look at you, a functioning person, which we are really just trillions of cells interconnected, working in perfect unison,
most of the time.
How did that happen, Animal? These people believe that we somehow, that your great grandmother was swinging through the trees on her tailbone.
I'd be funny there.
But that's what they're teaching these kids dogmatically. They're thinking of evolution.
These are things that are coming against us. But friends, I'm going to tell you, man was not created. He didn't come from some primordial soup. If he did, then he's gone from soup to nuts. We're no longer primordial soup. We're just plain out crazy. But no, man was created in the image of God, and man sinned willfully. He had a choice in the garden. Sin is not an accident. It is not an incident. It is high treason against the Most High God. I know, I'm in trouble. So, I love you. If you don't understand what sin is, you cannot understand the remedy that God has provided. The concept of sin has mostly been lost on this generation. The evolutionists, interestingly, say, like I said, we started with the different anthropods and working our way up. They say we're on an upward trend. However, we have 6,000 years of recorded history that tells us we're just as rotten and nasty as the day we got booted out of the Garden of Eden, if not worse. Man is not on an upward trajectory. Man is on a very self-destructive trajectory. Education, they say, well, we just need to educate people more. And if we get them educated enough, we can eradicate this problem called sin. I want you to think about this. This is sad. But what about Nazi Germany? If you look at them, they were highly educated people. But did it remedy the sin problem? No. If anything, it accentuated it. And universities, these places they call higher learning, they have become cesspools of sin and higher learning at the same time. So that doesn't work. Science says that through genetic manipulation, this thing called sin out of man. I don't know how many of you have read or studied on this, but they are now, I don't know, they might be doing it, said they can create designer babies. They can take the sperm and the egg, and they can take out certain chromosomes or add certain things. They genetically, you can decide what color hair your child is, what gender, all this other stuff. Oh, man, that would stink. I've never been a parent, but I'd kind of like to be surprised. All it came out what it's supposed to have, I mean, you know, that'd be kind of like one of the coolest surprises on the planet, you know, that you could ever get. You know, you're looking at, wow, look what I gave. But now they're trying to say, oh, well, we can genetically remove all these undesirable, which, by the way, who decides that? They're not using the Bible as the guidebook for undesirable. Secondly, they're trying to play God. What God does is right. But man always tries to imitate God. Sociologists say if we change the environment, man will do better. And we hear so much about it. He's saying, I'm the environment, environmentalist. God, he is just ad nauseum. First of all, you're here on this United. I explained to you the hypocrisy of these chuckleheads at the World Economic Forum meeting this last week, where over 1,000 planes flew overseas, emitting as much carbon as 350,000 cars for a month. It's
to sit there and say they're gonna put stuff on us to check our carbon footprint.
Okay.
As they sit in their 36 home mansion, burning more electricity and putting out more carbon than probably all of us in this church could be kept.
That's what we're up against, though. We're in a time of deception, but the deception also is in the church. If this were true, though, if we could somehow make the environment so good, it wouldn't matter. How can I say that?
I know of a couple that live in the most perfect environment you could imagine.
So this little couple you might throw named Adam and Eve. Can you imagine an environment any better than the Garden of Eden?
And yet what happened? They sinned.
So it's not an environment. But yet we're being told constantly, give them safe spaces. Give this. Make allotments.
No, what we need to give people is Jesus.
Psychologist and psychiatrist says that we just need to rid ourselves of these guilty thoughts. I've heard it. They'll fill you up. They'll have you drooling into things.
You can't even think straight. Now, I'm not talking about one little pill. Because some of these doctors actually might do some people some good things. But I've seen others where they will
pass out the pills, one right on the other. But listen, the pill might help with some of the way you process things. I'm not going to argue that. But what I am telling you is only God can change the heart and what's really causing the issues. And until you get to the root, you can cut the flower 100,000 times and the root's still going to be there and the flower's still going to come back.
We need to get to the root of things.
I'm getting the scripture in now. I'm sorry I told you that's why this is going to be a two-part series. It is the secret faults that we cause these moral earthquakes. The most important thing I want you to know, and I want to give you some scriptures to understand this, because this passage I'm going to read you, Jordan, there are two different ways that God deals with people. The first way we are ever dealt with is judicially. God is first and foremost, the judge, and we're judged by one thing and one thing alone, the blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You're either saved or you're not.
No gray areas. No in between.
I want to read this to you. We're going to start in 1 John chapter 1. I'm going to go ahead and read you the scriptures because I'm going to bring it back to you in just a minute. We're going to read through chapter 2, verse 6. And I'm going to give you part of it this week, part of it next week.
And the caption in my Bible has fellowship.
So starting in verse 5.
This then is the message which we have heard of him
and declare unto you that God is light.
And in him is no darkness at all.
If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie.
Amen.
And do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, boy, you might want to know the mind that's coming up. We have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from underlying this as well. This word is my favorite word, just about. All! I don't care if you're in the Greek, Hebrew, or whatever language you want to pick. That word means the same when you go right through them. All. All sin. If we say that we have no sin, now he's talking to say, oh, keep that in mind as he's talking about this, and I'm going to explain. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned,
we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, these things write I on you that you sin not. By the way, he's not giving people a license to sin here. He's saying, I'm writing this so you won't sin. So don't misunderstand the things I'm going to explain to you. And if any man sin, we have an advocate. By the way, that's just a dressed up term for lawyer. With the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. And he is the propitiation or satisfaction for our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. I want you to underline that verse and memorize it. One of the things that is spreading through the churches like wildfire, and we've been talking about it on Wednesday and Sunday nights, is this Calvinistic limited atonement viewpoint that says that Jesus only died for the elect. No man, no sir, right here, just as plain and bold as you'll ever want to see it. Jesus Christ died for every single person on that cross that day. He paid for every sin. If he left even one sin undone on Calvary, he must come back so we can crucify him again. But when he cried, it is finished from the hilltop, honey, he meant it's finished. It's done. I'm saved to the uttermost. I don't have to live in fear anymore. Not a saint. I have to fear my Papa in heaven. Because he can get a little angry with me sometimes. We're going to get to that in a minute. This is all going to make perfect sense. Let me finish this. Verse 3, chapter 2, verse 3. And hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments. Boy, that kind of shoots a hole in the theory of where we don't have to keep the commandments anymore. We just, you know, they're out of date, out of time. Wrong answer. He who says, I know him and keeps not his commandments. Boy, listen to the language he's using here. Is a liar and the truth is not in him. Whoso keeps his word in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know that we are in him. He who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk, even as he walked. Of course, that's referring to Jesus.
Amen.
First thing we need to understand, Romans is a great example of that. If you want a parallel to the right, when Paul wrote to the Romans, especially the first 8 chapters, he was dealing with them judicially. He was dealing with our sinful, unsaved condition. He's telling them in a very systematic way how to be saved. The culmination chapter is chapter 8, man. I'm telling you what, y'all heard it before. That's my favorite chapter in the whole Bible. There is no separation, and there is no condemnation. Boy, those are all going to be music to the believer's ears. But there's another way that God deals with us. But first of all, let's talk about the judicial part. Listen to Hebrews 12, verse 8. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness and their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. Friends, when you get saved, every sin, past, present, and future are buried in the grave of God's forgiveness. But I'm going to put a caveat to that and then say, hang with me. Listen also to Isaiah 43, verse 25. I, and he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and will not remember your sins. This is the gospel of grace. Grace is our starting point. We'll move on to Jeremiah 31 and 34. Once again, he repeats himself, I will forgive their sin and I will remember no more. Isaiah 1, verse 18. Come now,
mean when God remembers our iniquities no more? Does that mean he can't recall them?
No, he can't recall them. What it means is judicially, we have an advocate with the Father called Jesus Christ. So when he sees those sins, he sees them as covered by the blood and forgiven. And this is going on to my next point that I'll do next week. But understand this, there's two things that are going to come against you. One's the Holy Spirit to convict you of sin. A believer can't find themselves in a bad situation, amen?
Amen.
But Satan, he plays a different ballgame. He does things not to correct you and pick you up. He will do everything to point you to your past and pull you down. But guess what? God is not talking about intellectual remembrance. God said, I will remember their sin against them no more. You might want to remember that. Against them no more. God remembers our sin, but he remembers them as sins that have been forgiven and therefore forgotten as sins. Now, this is the way God deals with us judicially. Romans 4:8 says this, blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. Did you know judicially, I have some hard time saying stuff sometimes. My teeth get in the way. I don't hold them for me for a minute, please. Judicially, if God charges us with just one sin, I don't care if it's the most minor thing. You just had an ugly thought. And they're gone today, just like that. He would have no choice but to have you doomed and damned to hell. If he remembered literally one sin. One sin is all it takes to condemn any man. And whose sins? We've all sinned. But thank God, his grace is so incredible that it covers those sins. So what we have here is a very different thing. I want you to understand this. This is one of the false things that have been brought into the church and gets people thinking in the wrong direction. Now, it is important to live a godly life, but listen to me. Understand from a judicial standpoint, you cannot behave your way into heaven. Y'all quiet. Y'all understand what I just said? You cannot behave your way into heaven.
Amen.
Y'all need to understand that. It's not by works we're saved, lest any man should boast. It's only through the grace of God. See, look, that is my turn into a 3-week message. You see, this thing is getting longer. Really good. Let me speed this up. How then does God deal with our sins day by day? You say, I'm saved by grace and I'm kept by grace, and no sin will be charged against me, and my sin is buried in the sea of forgetfulness. How does God deal with me day to day? Friends, he deals with us not any longer as judge, but as Father. In this chapter, God is not dealing with them in a judicial way. Remember, he wrote in chapter 2, verse 1, my little children. He wouldn't be saying that to the lost. He's writing to a church, one of the churches he's established, or as a pastor of, or had been. He's talking to saved folk. So, we need to understand this, that he's dealing in a parental way. Did you know that when we were born into the family of God, two relationships are established? The first relationship is sonship. This is established by faith in Jesus Christ. It is
was adopted by my mother, my father. I got my dad's last name. And there is nothing that can be done that will undo that which happened.
By the way, that kind of excites me because in Romans, you'll read about we're adopted heirs. And I told you, in Roman history, it's just like even our American history with adoptions. You can't disinherit an adopted child. That's important. You need to have some confidence here that sonship, by the way, is something that will not change. When you get saved, you have brand new DNA running through your body. You're dead to yourself. You're now a trophy of grace. You've got Emmanuel's blood running through your veins. You've got a reason to shout even when all the world says you shall be on your knees crying. You've got glory. You've got Jesus on your side. That's the good news. The second kind is interesting because it's something we deal with, not just with God, but with each other. And this can change. It's called fellowship. That's your other ship. You got sonship, and you have fellowship. Fellowship can change. A lot of people, and I can't say I haven't been one of them, one day you're on the mountaintop, next day you're down in the valley. Man, it feels like you're on this great big roller coaster ride hanging on for all your work. Like, oh, Lord. Reason being, we're a father's child. And I want you to know something. As a child growing up, my relationship with my father, my earthly father, was a fixed. It was a legal, established thing. But we didn't always have fellowship. He would tell me, you need to go do X, Y, Z. And I'd immediately go out and do A, B, and C. We didn't always have a meeting of the minds. And of course, as my mother used to like to say, son, you are itching for a switching. So it is with our relationship with God. Sometimes we're walking in lockstep with the Holy Spirit. But how quick can we fall off of that ledge? Just like that. And I believe this just keeps growing. I don't know why I'm just up here. Sonship is established by birth. Fellowship is by your conduct, by the way. Verse 3, listen to this real quick. That which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. So that lets you know real quick that He is not talking about judicial forgiveness, rather parental forgiveness. And even one that we pray every Sunday, Matthew chapter 6, verse 12, we say, Our Father, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. It's an ongoing process of growing. It's being honest with yourself. It's not allowing those fault lines to build into a point where it starts to become friction, because here's the deal. You might be shook up, but if it gets bad enough, it starts affecting the body around you. I have seen blowouts of churches. I'm not going to name names, but we have had evangelists that I think they have repented and moved on. But people do not, a lot of them will not look at what they're doing now. They still point back to a mistake they made 30 years ago. Unfortunately, now for a true Christian, we're like, hey, it's under the blood. You made it right with God. Go on. But the world doesn't see it that way. And that's why it's very careful to diffuse the fault lines in our life before they turn into major earthquakes. How do we defuse the bomb? We confess our sins to Jesus Christ. Amen. Acknowledging that just because we're saved and judicially, we know we won't have to stand at the great white throne judgment, but there will be a Bema judgment. Day to day, we still need to have a relationship. That is all God has ever wanted from you. That is all He ever wants from me, is a day to day fellowship where He can love on us. And yet we push Him away. Many people say, Jesus is number one in my life. Well, how much time do you spend on the phone talking to your friends? How much time do you spend watching the TV? How much time do you spend with everything else now added up and multiplied? Put the time you spend in prayer. Or just in prayer, by the way, it doesn't have to be on your knees in a closet somewhere. It can be driving your car down the road and you're talking to God. Amen. Or in your workplace. Wherever you're at. Is your really number one? Put it together. I'm going to tell you this one to close, and I've got more, but I can skip. He hung up and the jury stood there and said, son, I am so sorry that you didn't get that job. And he went up and he said, that's all right, that was me. I was just checking up to see how it's going on my job. You see, sometimes we need to check up and see how we're doing on the job. And if we get a bad report, don't crawl away and hide. Confess it. Get up. Move on. Walk forward in the light of God. This might be a great sermon series. I don't know. I did not expect this to come. But I'm going to wrap it there. The question is, have you dealt with God judicially? I always ask this. Y'all know that. Have you accepted Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior? Because the rest of this will not be of any importance until you have found your way to the cross. There's only one way that the sin problem for man can be remedied, and that's through the blood of Jesus Christ. There's no other way. No matter what man may say, it's just a fool's errand. We have one source of strength. The Word of God. We only have one answer to sin's problem. His name is Jesus. There's only one way to heaven, through the blood. It says they washed their garments. And it's snowing the blood of the Lamb. Have you washed your garments this morning? Are you ready? You say, well, okay, Brother Mike, I've been ready, man. I'm excited. I'm on my way to heaven. Praise God, I'm cheering on. In your life, and maybe it doesn't seem like a big deal. See, that's one of Satan's favorite tricks. Not that big deal. We not that happy. As we're going to see, he mentions the word lie 3 times. I'm going to show you all some big stuff, and I can't get on this morning. But a lot of people live in a life where they deceive. They deceive themselves. They make excuses for things that God never planned for you. Excuse me. All sure.